afternoon and welcome to Stay Up Wood. Thank you for joining us. This is Mrs. Bowman. Don't worry, this is not a permanent thing. We've got a rundown of the week's announcements for you. After school activities and athletics are up and running, if you haven't signed up yet or still have questions, you're in luck because that is what we are talking about and heard after the show. Next week, come out and audition for Wood's fall play, Alice in Wonderland. Auditions will be either next Tuesday or Wednesday at 3:30. Join the Google Classroom with the code UZSYREA up there in the corner to complete an audition form and read over the script. The show will be performed virtually in early December, and students will need to commit to one rehearsal a week on either Tuesday or Wednesday. Interested in having your voice be heard in the newspaper or on a podcast? Join the Newspaper Podcasting Club this coming Thursday, October 8th at 3:30 p.m. The first meeting will be more of an interest and information meeting to see if this club is right for you. The Zoom information can be found on the daily morning announcements and will be shared with the community next week. Any questions? Ask me, Dawn_B_Bowman@mcpsmd.org. Also starting next week is the Getting Artistic with Google Club. Create slide pages for teachers to use or explore the creativeness of other Google programs like Pear Deck, Google Documents, and Google Draw. Your contributions could be used in class by teachers. This is also a club where you can earn service learning hours. Want to get involved with what is happening at school? Think there should be some changes for the better? You want your voice to be heard? Join us at the SGA Interest Meeting on Thursday, October 6th at 3:30 p.m. If you are interested in attending or have any questions, contact Ms. Grandy at claire_j_grandy@mcpsmd.org. Don't forget, we will continue the map testing next Tuesday during HEARD. Please be on time. Hearing the voices of others is pretty important because it helps us to see the world from a different viewpoint, not just our own. We are all not alike. We don't have the same traditions, the same foods, the same families, the same culture, but that's okay because it's what makes the world a wonderful place. We would like to take a moment to hear some voices from the Latino community in honor of Hispanic American Heritage Month. Take a look.
There's not a face for every culture, every ethnicity, every race. So when you tell me that I'm too dark to be Dominican, show me what a Dominican looks like. And then try to tell me that I'm not Dominican enough, because you're wrong. I'm Dominican, I'm Black, I'm an Afro-Latina, and you can't tell me any different. An Afro-Latina is simply a person who just identifies with their Blackness. That's it. I'm a Black girl and my family is from Dominican Republic. But people say I'm too dark to be Dominican. People say I can't be Latina. Growing up, there was no one who looked like me. I remember just being called charcoal. I remember being called too dirty. At one point, I stopped saying I was Dominican. My goal is simply to be able to help the youth feel comfortable in their skin and own it.
Oye, ¿qué lo que? Hello? ¿Ustedes me están mirando?
Most people know me as Monica Stalmuse over on YouTube, Instagram, you name it. I've been able to be extremely successful as an Afro-Latina in the beauty space. I'm not the best makeup artist, and never did I ever say I was, but I feel like if I can at least just inspire other people to just live in their own truth regardless of what other people think.
I know her because I follow her on Instagram.
Oh, she likes me.
I like her.
At first, when I started speaking Spanish on my channel, they were like, can you stop this? Can you just make a separate channel? And I said, you know what? No. This is who I am. And it was the best decision I've ever made for myself. Tu brillo te molesta, which means if my shine bothers you, that's not my problem.
You're in Mississippi. And everywhere you go, tamales. Those magical little snacks of corn flour and meat packed into a corn husk. Tamales, tamales, tamales. So if you've ever wondered what Mississippi tastes like, it tastes like me. My journey starts almost 100 years ago. It's 1930, and Mexican migrants are trickling into Mississippi. They bring along a taste of home, their version of the sandwich. Me, the tamale.
My great-grandfather came here from Mexico City, jumped the trains, ended up in Mississippi, he decided to make his family's homemade hand-rolled hot tamales. And in 1939, opened up this place and started selling tamales. You have to understand, this is a family thing. I'm the fourth generation. These same generational people who've been coming to the Big Apple Inn for the last 78 years are also generational. When they eat a tamale, they always have a story. My daddy used to bring me here. His daddy had the same kind of story. His daddy had the same kind of story. Tamales caught on here, and it became a staple in the city.
Just like Gino and his grandfather at the Big Apple Inn, I bring the Scott family together, a family who has gone on to be known as the first family of tamales in Mississippi.
In the early 50s, my father bought the recipe from a Mexican guy. My mother and father taught me. My sisters and my niece, all of us together, we making hot tamales. We just one big hot tamale family.
Much like the Scott family, the Doe family is made up of a long line of tamale makers. Doe's Eat Place is a landmark restaurant that helped propel me to become the backbone of Mississippi cuisine I've become today.
My daddy started this restaurant in 1941 with my mother. We've been here 76 years. Mama had a sister that was living here, and daddy had a couple, two or three sisters that were living here, so they all came and rolled tamales.
You know, a lot of people ask us, you know, how did tamales get prevalent in the Delta? It's been family. You know, the family's been here all the time.
As tamales made their way from Mexican culture to African-American communities and on to Mississippi's white population, there's one thing that remained a constant: family.
Our mariachi, Flor de Toloache, is different than most mariachis. We're formed in New York City. We're all women. Most people think of mariachi as being from Mexico, as being men, as being macho. And, you know, we're pretty much opposite of all those things.
I started my musical career playing with a local all-male mariachi in Brooklyn. I wanted to start my own group, and that led for me to do an all-female group. One of the most passionate music that I've ever heard. It's just beautiful. It's very heartfelt, and I think that's what makes mariachi so special.
This is what a typical bodega sounds like. But this bodega sounds a little different.
La única radio que tú escuchas todo el día.
Almost every street corner in New York City has a small store with sandwiches, groceries, and drinks. This is a bodega.
Soy Giovanni Valdez. Yo nací en República Dominicana. Yo iba a las estaciones de radio y yo decía esto, me gusta esto, yo quiero hacer esto. Me mudé a Nueva York en el 99. Bueno, empecé la radio aquí hace 4 años. No hay ninguna bodega que yo conozca que tenga radio como yo. Aquí en la bodega, yo soy Giovanni Valdés. Ya automáticamente entro a la radio, es DJ Yoba. Esto es Relambío FM, DJ Yoba en cabina, el DJ más Relambío. Relambío es una palabra que, ¿cómo se dice, Flor? Coquetear, coqueto. Entonces de ahí sacamos el nombre de Relambío FM, porque me decían el Relambío y cambié el nombre.
Nah. Buenas tardes, mi gente. Buenas tardes.
Mi show representa a la comunidad latina aquí en Brooklyn, en East New York. Tenemos alcance más o menos de 40,000 a 60,000 personas. Trato de complacerlo a todito un poco con su música. Una es música urbana. Una es música romántica, merengue, bachata, poca música clásica. Entonces yo decidí todo traerlo a una sola radio. Relambío FM, estamos más enfocados no solamente en música, es un top show involucrado con la comunidad. East New York, mucho tiempo atrás, era un área muy mala. Yo dije, ok, vamos y invitamos a la gente de, que escucha la radio a las reuniones comunitarias y tratar de arreglar los problemas que tenemos aquí en... Queremos recordarle que cualquier inquietud que usted tenga, es muy importante que usted asista a las reuniones. Gracias a la gente del Precinto 75 y en comunidad, en conjunto con nosotros, estamos haciendo un buen trabajo. Es bastante el apoyo que estamos teniendo en la comunidad después de la radio.
We hope you enjoyed their stories. Speaking of stories, did you know that this week is Banned Books Week? What is Banned Books Week, you may ask? It's a yearly event celebrating the freedom to read. It spotlights attempts to keep some books out of libraries and schools. What? It also spotlights the freedom we have to seek and to express ideas, even if some of those ideas are not so popular. The books featured during Banned Books Week have all been targeted for removal or restriction in libraries and schools. Hard to believe that, right? Well, it happens. Popular books like the Harry Potter series, The Hate U Give, Captain Underpants, they've all been targeted to be removed. So why do people do this? Well, it's usually because of religious beliefs or moral values. One of the books we are featuring today has made that list. It's a young adult novel called Juliet Takes a Breath by Gabby Rivera. Take a look at this author talking about her awesome book.
My name is Gabby Rivera. I'm a queer Puerto Rican writer from the Bronx, and my book is Juliet Takes a Breath. Juliet Takes a Breath is about a queer, chubby Puerto Rican girl from the Bronx who falls in love with feminism and sets up an internship with a kooky white hippie lesbian in Portland, Oregon. It is a coming of age tale that also wrestles with like sexuality and white feminism and what it means to be a queer person of color. Juliet finds her way through traveling from the Bronx to Portland. She also navigates coming out to her family and her relationship with her mom. And Juliet loves herself. And I wanted to write a book where a queer Latina was happy and joyful. And you should also know that Juliet Takes a Breath is coming out in Spanish. Juliet Respira Profundo. Yeah, thank you so much. My name's Gabby Rivera. This is my book.
Sounds like a great story, huh? I read it this summer. Excellent. Check out your copy on Sora today. Stop by the Banned Books Week module on Wood MS too for some other books that made that list. So we have some pet picks to share with you today. This is Bailey's cute kitty Deku. I hope I'm saying it right. She says that Deku is very sweet, but at times can be very mean. Doesn't that describe all of us at some point or another? He was found as a baby in a lawnmower after his mama abandoned him, poor kitty. Thanks for rescuing Deku, Bailey. We also have Joshua's pet bird, Blue. Having a pet bird must be an adventure. Blue likes to dance, and he's very sweet. He also likes to play with his brothers and sisters. Thanks, Bailey and Joshua, for sharing your pet with us. If you are interested in having your pet featured on the show, just go to the Wake Up Wood tab on the Media Center website and fill out the form. Time for the Friday Feel Good. This one definitely hits me right here. This little guy has never seen his mom and dad clearly until now. He was a little confused at first, but then he finally made the connection to what he was hearing and seeing for the very first time. If that doesn't make you smile, you need a hug. Before we sign off today, we have a share request from a student. It's our first one. Riley wanted to share a pic of her best friend. There's nothing like having a bestie. Thanks, Riley, for sharing that with us. If you would like to have something shared on the Stay Up Wood Show, just head to the Wake Up Wood tab on the Media Center website and fill out the form. That's it for us this afternoon. See you next week on Friday. Be respectful, be responsible, and be ready to learn. Have a great day and a great weekend.